Hello everyone and welcome. In this video we are checking out the 2016 Lexus IS200T. Now I have already tested the Lexus IS250 last year, and so we're going to be talking about the good, the bad, and the ugly in comparison to the Lexus IS250 as well as the Lexus IS350. Now, the major change from the 250 to the 200T is, of course, the engine. So instead of the 2.5 liter V6, it now has an inline 4-cylinder, 2 liters, and it's turbocharged rather than naturally aspirated. The new engine produces 241 horsepower versus 204 and 258 pound-feet of torque from just 1,650 RPM, so a lot of torque very early on. As a result of this, the 0 to 60 has gone down from 7.7 seconds to 6.9 seconds, so there has been an improvement in performance. Now, some of the other benefits of the IS200 over the previous generation is that now it carries over the brakes from the IS350, so you've got larger brakes, and it also carries over the 8-speed transmission rather than the previous 6-speed transmission. Finally, the new turbocharged engine is more efficient, and so it's now returning 22 in the city, 33 miles per gallon on the highway. So an added benefit with the fuel economy as well as being quicker. So, you know, you can't really complain about that. I did a fuel economy run. It did 33 miles per gallon in my own testing, which was primarily highway. So we've covered the good, moving on to the bad, and I mentioned that this now has the brakes from the IS350, which is great because it has larger brakes that have been carried over both the front and the rear. Now the reason for that, however, is unfortunate because this vehicle now weighs just 10 pounds less than the IS350. So it's got a 2-liter engine versus a 3.5 liter V6, and yet there's only a 10 pound difference. This car weighs 3,583 pounds. So a pretty hefty car, all things considered. It's got a 2-liter under there and it still weighs that much, and literally no different, I mean just 10 pounds from the IS350. So even though it has better fuel economy and it's faster, it is heavier. Now another difference versus the 350, so the price difference isn't all that big. It's about a $3,500 price jump to go from the IS200, which starts at around $37,000, versus the IS350, which starts at around $40,000. And the crazy thing is, so that's not that big of a jump, and you get a lot more performance for that $3,500. The crazy thing, though, is if you go for the F-Sport. So I'm currently in the IS200T F-Sport, and that starts at the exact same price, as the IS350 starts at. And so, you know, if you're going for performance, sportiness, as the name implies, F-Sport, you would think you'd probably want a little bit more power. And so I can't think of a good reason why you would want to go with the IS200T F-Sport versus the IS350, aside from fuel economy. You know, it's going to be a little bit better fuel economy, but aside from that, the cars weigh the same. One has a lot more power, and so obviously it's going to be more fun to drive. So my pick would be the IS350, and that's kind of the bad news about this vehicle as far as the IS200T F-Sport, and it's just because the price is the exact same as the base IS350. So we've covered the good, we've covered the bad, and now let's get ugly. Now, looks are a matter of opinion. It's a purely subjective thing, and I don't typically like talking about that, but I do think this is a genuinely good-looking vehicle. I was trying to find something that I thought we could all agree on wasn't very attractive about it, and I think even the engine cover on this vehicle looks good, which is saying something because I really don't like engine covers, but I thought it looked good on this car. I think the one thing that I was able to pick out as the front license plate bracket didn't look attractive, and you know, that's kind of obviously nitpicking, and that is to say that this is a gorgeous car. I think it genuinely does look really good. One feature in the future that you may want to avoid is a heated steering wheel, because if you get into a car with a heated steering wheel, you're never going to want to drive anything else. It's so nice to have a heated steering wheel, especially if you have like super long lanky arms where blood flow never reaches your hands and so they're always frozen, and then you can put them on this nice warm steering wheel. And then you go back to your Subaru and you're thinking like, oh man, I wish this thing had a heated steering wheel. It's really a luxury to have heated steering, and I always get kind of bummed when I drive cars without it now. And that's very sad because it's like, how ridiculous of a creature comfort is it to have a heated steering wheel, like something to heat your hands because they're cold while you're driving. But it's an amazing feature, and if you can find one with it, yeah, you should definitely go for it. Now, this vehicle does come with paddle shifters, so you can change gears on your own. Something that I've noticed with all Lexuses that I've driven, and this is a transmission which I have used before in another Lexus, they're just slow to, you know, shift gear. So the delay between pressing the button and the gear shift actually occurring is fairly long. And the shift itself honestly isn't even that smooth. So, you know, it feels best if you just leave it in automatic mode and let it do the shifting. But, you know, it's kind of fun to shift it yourself, and sometimes going down hills and things like that, you may want to do it anyways. So I understand that. The upshift there is actually pretty quick. I think it's the downshifts where you kind of get a long delay. And maybe there's some logic built in where you want to be on the brakes and then it does it a little quicker versus if you're just randomly selecting between them. Lots of people hiking today in Oregon. It's a beautiful sunny day for once, and I'm on summer tires. It's like, hey, things have worked out. Actually, speaking of the tires, this thing has a sticker on the side that says that the tires may only last for 15,000 miles. So, you know, a lot of grip on the tires that have come here, and they just, I guess, shred off fairly quickly. Now, as far as the engine, there's actually really noticeable turbo lag. And, you know, that's interesting to me. Basically, what happens when you get into the boost, how it works is you floor it, and then you get very close to atmospheric very quickly. So you hit atmospheric pressure with full throttle, and then you wait a little bit. So you get kind of slammed initially when you put your foot down as it hits atmospheric. Then you wait a little bit, and then it goes almost to peak boost very quickly. So when you do put your foot down, it's kind of like this two-step process where first you get full atmosphere, and then you get full boost. And it's kind of like a boom, and then boom again, which is, it's a weird sensation, and there's very clear turbo lag there in the engine. I have been impressed with the sound system in here. It is not the Mark Levinson, which I would recommend upgrading to, because all the cars which I've had with that Mark Levinson audio, they've just sounded phenomenal. The bass audio is actually pretty decent, but one of the things I really admire about Lexus as a company is their Mark Levinson audio systems throughout their line, and it's just an incredible experience with those speakers and the way they've tuned it and the amplifier. I don't know how it's done, but it sounds amazing, that audio system. Coming into some corners here, the steering does feel good in sport mode. I actually do like it. It's got a good weight to it. It's actually a pretty heavy steering overall, and then in sport mode it reduces the amount of assist, so it's even heavier. And it does have a nice feel to it. It builds as you come into the corners. Not too much body roll, and these tires do have a great amount of grip because they're shredding off, I guess, and they only have 15,000 miles of life in them. But it definitely does kind of come alive in these corners here, even though it is a really heavy vehicle. The turbo is a bit of fun, rear-wheel drive, and the ability to manually shift. Actually pretty flat through these corners. All right, now we're gonna test out the 0-60. So I've got it in manual shift mode. I've got the traction control completely disabled. We're gonna come to a stop. We've got great conditions, excitingly. So hopefully this will be a good time. Put it down into first gear, foot on the brake, foot on the gas. Let off at about 2000 RPM. I was a little late on that shift there. And 60, it does have two shifts to get to 60. So that's gonna take up a little bit of time. It's just shifting gears. And I could have done a little bit better with the first gear shift. I waited a little bit too late, but not too much. It just hesitated a little bit there at red line. So overall, we'll see what that comes out to. Driving on the highway, it's actually decently quiet. I measured earlier going at about 65, about 75 decibels, which is on par with the last IS250, which I tested. So decently quiet in here. You do hear a decent amount of road noise from the tires there, not too much wind noise. And overall, you know, it's quiet in here, so you could hold a conversation, anything like that, without too much worrying. So thank you guys for watching. And if you have any questions or comments, feel free to leave those below.